Hello and good morning, friends. Today I want to talk to you about pump chambers and septic systems. What do they mean? Why do they exist? What are the use cases for them? What do you do as a homeowner that has a house that has a pump chamber? Let's get into it. So generally with a septic system, most of those systems are going to be gravity fed, and as you put water down the toilet, the gravity itself will pull that water into the tank, solids will fall out as a separation, and then the water will work its way on into the absorption system. Sometimes that can't happen, right? Let's just say, for example, that you have a very steep hill that you have to go up, or a really long distance, or maybe you have to get away from the well, or maybe you have something like a drainage pond, right? So in this particular circumstance, we have a pump chamber on a property that has a drainage pond. Not that big of a deal, happens quite a bit. But there's a few reasons for what would happen to cause somebody to even have to consider a pump chamber with a drainage pond. Because as you can see, the pond's over there, but the septic is not anywhere near it, right? So with a septic system, right? Just concrete box, nothing special. All of the liquid from the house goes to it. Heavy stuff falls to the bottom, lighter stuff stays to the top, and then the liquid will progress on. A pump chamber is just another septic tank that's actually gonna have a pump in it, just like you see with the sump pump, that will take, grind up the stuff, send it off into the drain field, right? So if we look over here, see that we have a septic tank, right? Normal, standard, plain Jane tank. We've got clean out right there, riser in the middle, the back of the tank's gonna be right over here, right? Normal, completely normal septic system, nothing crazy. From there, the water will go over to this. This is what we refer to as the pump chamber. Now, as we can look inside, we'll see that the pump chamber is going to have water coming in. And we'll also see down here that there's a float right over there, right? And then underneath of it will actually be the pump. The pump is going to be down under the water. And what will happen is that float will go up and turn the pump on. So it has already finished a cycle, because as you can see, the float's sitting down. So now we gotta wait for the water to fill back up to see if that float works again. Generally, when you're gonna have problems on a pump chamber, it almost always is gonna be something to do with the float or the pump itself, right? I usually find that the most common issues for a high water alarm or a pump failure call is actually the float itself goes bad, and you just gotta switch out the float and then you're in good shape, right? So with the pump, it's very similar to a sump pump. It's mechanical. It will work until it doesn't work. And that's why you want to have some kind of alarm system to tell you, hey, the pump's not working, call somebody, right? So we don't end up having sewage come back into your house. The problem with systems that have a traditional septic tank to a pump chamber is that if that pump fails for whatever reason, the drainage of your water, your wastewater, is going to be basically non-existent, and you're going to have to run the problem of all that debris and all that junk getting back into your house, right? And that can be problematic. So how people go ahead and navigate this situation is they get what's called a high water alarm. It'll be the exact same kind of float as what you see in there for the pump itself, but it'll actually be there to turn on the alarm in the home. So when the pump, or when the float's up, the alarm will sound off, and then when the float's down, the alarm will not go off. For this particular property, they had the float just kind of sitting on the lid. Bad idea, don't do that, right? But the purpose of this is to tell you as a homeowner, stop running water, call somebody. The alarm generally, at least in our area, is gonna be a little black box. Sometimes they're a big gray box, and sometimes they're a tiny gray box with two black little tags to them, right? So they come in a variety of shapes and colors and sizes. It doesn't really matter as long as it's loud enough for you to hear it, right? So let's just say, where do you find this alarm? Generally in our area, the alarms are gonna be put in the utility room next to the electric panel. Sometimes if you can't find that, the best place to look would be whatever side of the house the sewer pipe's coming into, right, or out of. So for perspective, right over here is where the main sewer line comes in, right? Right now we're running water to make sure that the pipes are open and clear. But let's just say you couldn't find the alarm panel. You want to look on that part of the wall to see if you can get lucky and hopefully find the stupid thing. Some pumps and some pump chambers actually wouldn't have a high water alarm, believe it or not. Back in the 90s, in times like that, it wasn't required, right? So you'd get a lot of installers, especially like in places like Anne Arundel County in Southern Maryland, they would just slap a pump in, call it a day. Bad idea. Don't do that. If you don't have a pump in your system or an alarm in your pump chamber system, you're going to want to make sure that you get one installed so that way you don't have to worry about that risk of sewage coming into your home, right? So we already discussed what they look like. We've talked about how the pump works. We've talked about the alarms. We've touched a little bit into why you would have a pump chamber, but let's take a look at this particular example, right? So if we look over on the far side of the property, we're going to see that there's actually a drainage ditch leading to the drainage pond, right? The pond that's over yonder. So when you have a ditch like that, you got to try and figure out where you're going to put the septic system so that way you don't have groundwater flowing directly on top of it, right? You have to have a certain amount of distance between groundwater and your sewage. So let's take a look over here. See here that there's actually a nice trench with a lot of stone leading right off into that pond, right? So you can't obviously have your drain fields run through this because you'll be swamping it out every time it rains. So like last night, we had a huge rainstorm with a lot of tornadoes. If you had your trenches over this, obviously this septic system would be swamped. So you have to pump it somewhere away from this part, right? That's where we get into where the drain fields are currently. So it might be a little bit difficult to see on the camera, but you can see one trench here, 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 and then there's one more way over there, right? So how we find these trenches, especially when there's a pump chamber, is we're gonna use a probe just like this, right? Sometimes with these older houses, you have to use a probe and physically go up to the trenches and hit the stone with the probe to confirm that yes, you are in the drain field. Sometimes you can get lucky, and if it's a recent install within the last 15, 20 years, there might actually be a observation port or a little 4-inch PVC access point to the box so that way you can find the trenches way easier. This house was early 2000s, so that wasn't a requirement. Not a big deal if you don't have that kind of access, but it does make it a little bit harder as a homeowner to find where are your drain fields. So generally, if you don't have access to the distribution box, we'll usually recommend that you consider putting it in, but for this particular property, super easy to figure out where those drain fields are. So as long as they're not building on it, it doesn't really make that much of a difference. So in summary, basically, you're only gonna find pump chambers on properties that have large elevation, groundwater issues, or maybe there might be some soil issues. If you do have a pump chamber, very important to make sure that all the electrical components are sealed correctly, the floats are put in correctly, they have separate float trees, and that the pump actually works. You wanna also make sure that you have a high water alarm. If you have a high water alarm, it's a good idea, in my opinion, to go out and check it every 6 months to a year, just to make sure the stupid thing works, right? In the house, there'll actually be a button to hit test. That's a good way to do it, but I would always recommend to physically come out here, physically pull it to make sure that the wire connects to that alarm panel. I've had it so many times where somebody puts a fence post in, they cut the electric wire to the alarm, inside test works, pulling the actual float doesn't work. And the only way they know that is when obviously it backs up, right? So I hope this was useful. I hope we had a good discussion today, right? If there's an area of conversation or a topic you want me to cover, leave a comment below, right? I try to get to all of them as quick as I can. We're here to grow together. I'm trying to help out the homeowners of the world, see how the systems work, discuss maybe there's something that we're gonna talk about that you've never experienced before, or you've never seen, and you're anxious and you're concerned. My goal is to help make it a little bit more sense for you, right? So if you can hit that like button, subscribe. I have more videos posted every day on the World of Well and Septic. Till next time, guys.